Riffs are too repetitive, the lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides and the cover art's a mess. There's so much here to tear apart. Listen to it for a week, now that week has passed. Why I hate this album podcast with Tim and Garrett.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Why I Hate This Album, the show where we pick an album or a song, listen to it for an entire week straight, and then come back here to tell you whether or not we hate it and why. I am one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey, with me as always, co-host extraordinaire, Glenn Gary to my Glenn Ross, Timothy Richardson. Tim, the listeners have written in and they want to know, how are you doing?
Well, Garrett, this has been a weird 2 weeks.
I agree. It's been a nice, well, it's your turn, please. Why have they been strange for you?
Well, Garrett, I've been in Philadelphia, or Philly, to those of you who have been. And I would just like to say, up top, before I talk about my experiences in Philadelphia, everyone from that city is an upstanding citizen. They are good people, salt of the earth, kind, generous, God-fearing Americans. Hmm. That being said, those people are all fucking animals, Garrett. I saw a man scream at the top of his lungs at his own reflection in a store window for what seemed like minutes. I don't know how he didn't pass out. I saw two men literally wrestling over the last bit of a bottle of vodka. And weirdly, ooh, it was like Smirnoff. So, you know, it's not like the cheapest of vodkas.
Maybe that's why they were so eager to get every last drop.
Fair enough. I saw a man bathe in a public water fountain like an old-timey prospector in an outdoor bathtub.
Wow.
I walked past a very well-dressed, very well-put-together gentleman smoking a cigarette on his cell phone, screaming into that phone, "That's because he's a cocksucker." And you can tell him that from me. You tell him he's a cocksucker right to his cocksuck face.
I mean, to be fair, everyone on this podcast has been that guy before.
Well, sure, but not well-dressed.
No, only half of us have been that guy. Oh, goodness.
I saw 103 prostitutes.
That's weird to have.
It was enough that I started counting. You're right.
Do you think there were even more than you just only started counting after the first dozen or so?
Probably. There were probably some like incognito prostitutes. Also, how many of those prostitutes
had you called?
Well, none, Garrett. None.
Oh, wow. That is a lot then.
Milling about.
Just milling about. Did you see anybody partake or at least rent one for the evening?
No, I saw a couple people talking to them. It might have been a negotiation. I don't know.
That's always very funny to me.
Yeah. In Chicago, I once saw a man drop off a prostitute at like 10:30 in the morning. It was pretty hilarious.
I had dinner once across from a man who was having dinner with a prostitute.
Interesting.
Not different tables. We weren't like on a double date.
That would have been great.
Anyway, no, I'm sorry. It was one of the few times in my life that I was like 100,000% sure she was a prostitute. like you couldn't have done it more characteristically. She was very young for how old he was and like very attractive, but also dressed like a whore.
Like a whore. It looked great. Like a whore, Sandy. Honestly, I think it'd be very funny to tell one of your friends that you're going out for some sort of prostitute's dinner and he should get himself a prostitute and that you will both be bringing prostitutes and going on a double date. If only to see what, when this friend goes out looking for a prostitute, what level prostitute does he bring?
Here's the thing. I love this idea. Can law enforcement listeners, I know there's a few of you out there, if I call a... What would they be? Not a detective, but if I call a cop, if I know a cop, or if I hire a cop, you can hire him to like do traffic at a church. You can hire him to do this. If I hire a cop to witness my transaction with the prostitute, specifically saying I am purchasing you strictly for dinner, is that legal?
Honestly, I don't understand why it's illegal to hire prostitutes until you are physically inside of them. I don't think you should be able to be arrested unless you are physically inside of them and money has changed hands. For example, around here, we often hire prostitutes to paint walls and stuff.
Oh, sure.
Well, I'm just saying, but like, this is the same situation. I go out on the street, I find prostitutes, I pay them money, I bring them back home, and then I make them do chores.
Yeah, but I feel like we've been hassled before, but when we show them like the cleaning supplies, the paint, the spackling, the mortar, the drywall, talking very specifically about your wall holes, The police have let us go because we are clearly picking up these women of the evening to give them an opportunity to do anything other than suck smelly dicks.
Honest labor is what we are offering them. Garrett!
Are you saying dick sucking is not honest labor?
It's
dishonest labor?
Well, no, you know what? It's honest labor.
Yeah, as long as it's not one you get it. Anyway, let's
anyway,
not.
Garrett, I had a woman in a full burqa scream at me to support the black community by voting for Trump, or at the very least, and I'm quoting her here, not vote for the bitch.
Wow.
Yeah.
There's a lot of conflicting messages in that anecdote.
Yeah. It was magnificent. I was actually there with somebody, happened to be, who is a lifelong Big Appler, and he told me that this is what the Big Apple was like in the 80s and 90s, and I feel robbed by this experience of living here.
I would say after the tales you have regaled me with, and the fairly, dare I say, gentrified, almost nerfed experience that we have here in the city, I gotta say it, New York, up your game.
Yes,
you need to step it up,
that.
New York City.
I agree with that. You should. This will be fun for both sides. Try to rob Garrett on the street.
You know, I almost immediately tried to dissuade our listeners. I almost called them customers. Our
they
listeners.
They are in a way, Garrett.
In a weird way, except they don't pay us anything. And technically, I don't think any of them actually meant to listen.
I'm pretty sure we don't give them anything either.
Also fair. Anyway, normally, my gut, my instinct is to say, don't do whatever Tim just said. But in this one instance, game on.
Yeah, see if you can. If you want to test your mettle, try to rob Garrett.
Are we doing weapons or no weapons?
Doesn't matter, Garrett. I've tried to rob you with weapons. It won't matter.
Okay, well, just know that I will also be carrying weapons.
Yeah,
unconventional weapons.
And some conventional ones.
Depends. Do you think throwing stars are conventional?
I do. I think the nerve gas is unconventional.
All right, Tim. Well, that's a great recap of Philadelphia.
It's a horror show and I loved it.
Yeah, I guess we'll move on to the rest of the show. What album have you been listening to for an entire 2 weeks straight?
I have been listening to the debut album of Mr. Luke Albert Combs. This One's For You, released June 2nd, 2017.
And Tim, after an entire dose weeks with the Combster, I'm real curious. And be honest, do you hate this album?
Oh, I am so very close, Garrett. A light breeze could get me there this week, I think. This album sucks, Garrett.
Yeah.
This, I want to be real clear. This guy could have done better than this. Maybe on his later albums he does. But this is like, we'll get to it in the history. He spent a lot of time perfecting these songs, and these songs suck. I don't know if he's not trying or if his songs have been ruined by suits. We'll speculate later. But this album sucks. What about you? Do you love this album, Garrett? I know you were talking about how much you were into this album and how you hoped I didn't hate it so that you wouldn't feel stupid for liking it.
None of this happened. You are a liar.
Do you hate this album?
No.
Right. Because you're stupid.
And I love it. And I think it's awesome. And I smell its farts. Whatever you said, sure. No, this album sucks. Here's a hard question for you, Tim. I'm biased. I used to own bullshit country music and tell myself how much I liked it. If anyone's curious, I'm talking about your Pat Greens and your Cory Moros and other ones whose names I've forgotten to time. This is worse than that.
Oh, it's way worse. It's way worse because those guys, at least it was semi-indie.
Yeah, right? They were songs about places and things they had done and been to.
Right. This is, well, we'll get into it, but...
Can't even talk about it yet. But do I hate it? No. And here's why. The song suck, but they are really almost perfectly executed. Like,
right.
To mediocrity.
But that's, like, I think that's a point against it. We'll get there in general thoughts.
Okay, yep, you're right. We're champing at that bit.
I agree completely with everything you've said, and I think it's all a bad thing.
God, okay, well, maybe I am going to be caught off guard this week, and you're just going to get me there out of nowhere.
We'll see.
Yeah, the surprise gets you there. I might just scream when it happens.
Jesus Christ.
I am. So that you know. We'll see. You don't hate it, but you can see it on the horizon. I don't hate it. I'll be shocked if I end up hating it. Before we can get there, though, I'm really curious. Prior to this week, Tim, had you ever heard a Luke Combs song?
No. I have no history with this album, with any of this guy's music. May have a little history with the man itself. We'll get to that when we get to that. Little surprise for you and the listener, but I've never heard his songs before. No, no. What about you? Have you heard his music?
No, no. I'm exactly the same story, minus the weird illusion that you two may or may not know each other, which is ominous. Can't possibly be what I think it is. Yeah, so exact same history as you. Interested to find out how you may or may not know this man. I'm sure we're about to find that out. And the way we do that is I ask you, Tim, to take us on a journey. Help us understand who is Lucius Combs and how did this one's for you come to be?
Lucius Luke Albee Combs was born in Huntersville, North Carolina in 1990. Now, I usually try to find some fun facts about the town or some famous people that are from there, but as you would expect, it's a town of 60,000 people that has produced almost exclusively NASCAR drivers, MLB pitchers, and the current Patriots quarterback. So, not that interesting. His family moved to the big city, Asheville, North Carolina, birthplace of slightly better musician Warren Haynes, and Lucas began doing elementary through high school musicals and singing in his church choir. He did take one guitar lesson in seventh grade and hated playing guitar. After high school, he went to Appalachian State University in Boone, North Carolina, go Wildcats, alma mater of Dr. Stephen M. Greer, American physician who retired from the medical field to pursue his true interest, UFOs. In 1990, coincidentally the year Luke was born, Greer founded the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, C-City, not to be confused with SETI, which is a actual thing, and he produced the documentary Sirius, about that 6-inch skeleton that they claimed was an alien but turned out to be a Chilean baby. So, you know, 50% credit, I guess.
Oh, no.
I thought it was Peruvian.
I don't think so. I think Chilean.
No, I'm sure you're right. You'd done the heavy lifting. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Giancarlo Esposito narrated, I don't think that one, but a different one of his terrible documentaries about nonsense.
Oh, I shouldn't do that. God. I love that he made his little organization, like, confusably Googleable to be SETI.
Oh, absolutely.
Legally distinct SETI.
Yeah. Weirdly, though, he has found quite a bit of evidence for UFOs and alien intelligence. We'll get into that on a different episode. Anywho.
Doubt it.
While at Appalachian State University, Luke wanted to get a business degree. Then he studied criminal justice. He decided he was going to be a homicide detective while also working as a mediocre bouncer at a mediocre bar and suffering from excessive anxiety and severe OCD.
So far, I like this guy.
Yeah, sure. The summer before his senior year in college, he went home to work at a go-kart track. And his mom reminded him that he had that guitar from seventh grade with that single lesson before immediately quitting. She said, and I'm quoting here, "Just do something that isn't go-karting or sitting in your room masturbating." Anything.
Gross.
Anything is what she allegedly told him. Well, old Sticky Fingers Combs picked up that guitar and he learned to play, Garrett. When he went back to college, he continued to be a bouncer, but he also got to play sets at the bar he was bouncing at. I guess they just left the door unattended during those times. And eventually, he just started playing 4 to 5 nights a week instead of bouncing. He put a band together, did some kind of local tours.
Hey, come see Luke Combs during the underage hour, because we've got no bouncer. That's right, ladies. We're not checking any IDs because he's on stage. This is not a good promotion.
It's pretty good promotion.
I mean, I'd have gone at 17.
Absolutely. We did go. Well, I went.
Anyway.
We were 17 at much different times. Anyway, he started putting videos of his shows on Vine because that was a thing, Facebook and YouTube, where he got a little bit of attention. And he ended up dropping out of college 1 month before graduation and moving to Nashville to make it big, making his mom wish she had not discouraged the masturbation. He self-released 2 EPs in 2014 and another in 2015, then released his first single, Hurricane, in 2016, which, despite sucking, sold 15,000 copies the first week and hit number 46 in the Billboard Hot Country chart. He signed to Sony Music Nashville and its label Columbia Nashville, which I was unaware was the same thing. They re-released Hurricane. It hit number 1 on the country radio charts, and he's off and running. He released the album of the week, this one's for you in 2017. More on how that did at the end, but spoiler alert, it did okay. He was immediately made a member of the Grand Ole Opry in 2019. He released his second album, and then COVID happened, Garrett. And, you know, everyone had to stop touring, but he didn't want to miss out on a potential goldmine, so he recorded and released the single 6 Feet Apart in March of 2020. Feels like he had that already written somehow. What I'm saying is, Luke Combs knew about COVID before the rest of us.
Luke Combs worked in a lab in Wuhan.
Interesting. Garrett Harvey, words, not mine.
I'll edit it a different way.
Oh, I mean, listen, I still co-sign it. let's set up a website, lukecombsdidcovid2020.com, and then all the traffic can go there. Maybe it redirects to our website.
Yeah, we'll get on it, nerds.
In 2022, he released his third album, Growing Up. He then collaborated with Sir Ed Sheeran for a single that ended up on an Ed album.
That does not surprise me at all.
No, this is the country version of Ed Sheeran. In 2023, he released his fourth album, Getting Old. Also that year, one of his fans, Nicole Harness, began selling homemade drink tumblers with pictures of Luke Combs on www.amazon.com. She sold 18 of them and made a cool $380.
Nice.
Yeah. Then he, or rather a legal team that represents him and prevents counterfeit merch from being hawked online, sued her and a bunch of other people doing similar things. She was unaware she'd been sued as the email went to a junk email box, and then by the time she figured out what was happening, her account had been frozen by a judge, and she had been ordered to pay Luke an even cooler $250,000.
Awesome
sauce.
Which
is hilarious. Now, to his credit, when he was found out about this, / when he was called out on this, he claimed not to know anything about it. This was a legal team that operates on his behalf to basically discourage this, and he offered her $11,000, which I think is twice what the judge froze, to not make him seem like an asshole publicly, which is all and good. But here's the problem. They sued hundreds of other people concurrently that had also been doing this. And the way these lawsuits work is basically there's a very immediate option to cease and desist and also give them money. So there's probably a shit ton of people out there who that email did not go to their junk email and who just paid these assholes a whole bunch of money.
Oh yeah, almost certainly. They paid like an immediate $350 summary judgment or some shit.
But yeah. Earlier this year, he released a single for the Twisters soundtrack featuring the notably handsome Glenn Powell, Go Wildcats, and released
Stop
a Father's
Day him like that.
And released a Father's Day album called Fathers and Sons in June 2024, and that's pretty much it.
Alan, a Father's Day album?
It was released 2 days before Father's Day, and it's called Fathers and Sons. I assume it's an album about fathers and sons and Father's Days.
All I want is for somebody to make an entire album that is dad themed, but they need to be like a real artist. Like this is a true, like,
so you want Jack White's next album to be essentially a bad version of Cat Stevens.
Yes. That's exactly what I want. That.
It sounds so insane. No covers, though. That's really clear. Like they have to be all originals.
Yeah. I don't want Cats in the Cradle, all that shit. That's obviously about fathers. I need original material.
It's also obviously about fathers.
Oh, it needs to be overtly about dads. Like at least one song's called like My Daddy and Me.
Yeah, or
Looking
Fathers
at
Pops. And Sons.
Yeah, the album's called Fathers and Sons. We're not hiding it. We want everyone to know this is a celebration, not just of dads, but of the relationship between fathers and sons. You know who's just weird enough to actually do this? John Mayer.
Oh, we'll get into John Mayer.
Yeah, we will get into John Mayer quite, in quite short order.
This guy apparently loves John Mayer.
I got a lot to talk about there. anywho. Great history, Tim. We really need to replace the cursory end of history Shia LaBeouf, but I've just not been feeling anything.
Dental plan.
Lisa needs braces, of course. Let's give it a Dilophosaurus. It just doesn't feel natural. Shia LaBeouf.
How about
Shia
a
LaBeouf
fathers and sons? I say fathers and you say and son. No. Oh, that's stupid. That's
no.
stupid.
Well, I mean, I kind of love it. I mean, unless you hate it.
I do.
All right, we've wasted enough time being and dumb. Great history, Timbo. That brings us to general thoughts musically. Is he a good singer, Tim?
Yes, he's a very good singer.
Very good singer.
The problem that I have with his voice, because I think he has a great voice for Nashville pop country music.
Concur.
Problem being, I don't like that. I much prefer the Warren Haynes thing. I much prefer country music of the 70s thing. Like, country music to me should sound a little pained. I should be able to tell that you have at least done a little bit of meth by the way your voice slurs on S's. If you could sing on American Idol, you don't get on my headphones. Go fuck yourself.
Yeah, that's fair.
And I mean, again, I think he's very talented. I think the problem is the suit. This guy, if left to his own devices, the lyrics would be the same. But I think that the vocals...
wouldn't be so dressed up.
It would be a lot rawer.
You know, it's funny. A number of the bands you and I listen to will occasionally take 1 to 3 of their songs and be like, here's the bluegrass slash country version of these songs. And it's great. Modern country music has done the inverse, but it's for every song.
Yes.
They're like, here's the rock and roll version of this country song.
But it's not even the rock and roll version. Again, it is the Ed Sheeran, like, pop version.
Yeah. And at times I would even say, like, here's a Drake song, but country.
Yeah, go fuck yourself,
whining.
Florida, Georgia line. It's, well, right, because this, he feels like the kind of country musician, at least this album does, that it doesn't aspire to be your Johnny Cash or your Townes Van Zandt.
No.
It aspires to be Blake Shelton or Big and Rich or Brooks and Dunn or whoever the fuck. Like, it aspires to be Troil instead of Townes Van Zandt, and that's a problem if you're making country music.
I think you're onto something with this Bricks name for a new country duo. Bricks and Mortar, Bricks and Sand.
I like that.
Yeah. I'm Bricks, and this here is Mortar. I don't know why Bricks and Sand sound better.
It does, but that means less. I think Bricks and Mortar.
Much less. Yeah. I'm Mortaring, is my friend here, Brooks. We're going to sing some songs for you, mostly about masonry.
I'd listen to that, too. As far as topics, like from a very 30,000 foot level, and this is just for you, this guy feels like a real Stephen King.
Let me see if I can define it. Emotionally immature and a whiny and frankly off-putting, low self-esteem.
Sure, but also shouting America fuck yeah a whole bunch and grilling with your shirt off even though it's...
Boy, that guy had the physique of a glazed ham.
Did we bleep his name? Probably not. Fuck that guy.
Who knows? I don't care.
But there's also, okay, so there's 21 musicians that play or sing on this, including one guy named Howard Duck that I'd like to hear more from. There's 9 people involved on the technical side, the mixing, engineering, producing, mastering, etc. It feels way overproduced in a very specific way that only country music could. It's like a lot of these things, you really need to cut back on the instrumentation. Again, make it more like Pat Green or something like that. It would be better for it.
Yeah, get a guitar, a bass, some drums, and maybe a mandolin or a washboard or a pedal steel. That's it.
It's weird because the songs sound fairly different. Like,
yes.
But there's never a time where you're just like, oh, this one feels different because of the fiddle. Like, no.
Right.
Because that never comes up. Why would it?
They become this like bland garbage lyric delivery system.
Yeah. Yeah. They're all very formulaic. I mean, they're all very much the 2 verses, a chorus, a bridge, maybe a guitar solo. They all have 2 to 3 co-writers on here. I don't really know what those people are doing. Generifying it, I guess. I don't know.
Somebody is ruining somebody's songs. And yes, either it's Luke ruining those people's songs or these people ruining Luke's songs. These, get ready. Gino, watch out. Here comes a hot take. I would rather listen to Train than this.
Okay, so you do hate this.
I at least Train... I don't know. It has some personality, this stuff. And, you know, full disclosure, I don't love country music. It's not my favorite music by any means, but I own and can listen to country music that isn't this. This is just bad.
Yeah, I have a fair amount of country music on vinyl that's all of which I would happily play, some of which is from people that listen to this show.
Oh, yeah, you do.
This is...
Would you rather listen to Sheeran?
Okay, here's the thing about Sheeran.
He's in love with The Shape of You?
He is in love with The Shape of Me. He will at least throw on a couple of songs that are so batshit insane, and I don't know if it's like a cultural difference, if I don't understand an idiom or something, but it's at least way more entertaining than this, because this is generic.
Yeah, boring.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to rip through these songs today because there's not a lot of speculation for a lot of it.
Yeah. Fair enough. Let's get to it then, Garrett.
Fantastic.
Track number one, Out There.
We're out there somewhere where we can go.
So I hope you got money from Chevy for this, right?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
It even starts with car sound effects, and then
There's car noises,
and then it just proceeds.
Truck noises.
It's as bad as a James Buffet song about one of his dumb restaurants. It's just a Chevy commercial.
It is pretty much a Chevy commercial.
It's all the fun things you can do with the truck.
Yes, and well, then it slowly devolves from like a very generic Chevy commercial that I would argue by the end of the song you're like, what are you guys doing in the woods?
Yeah, it's a Chevy commercial, but it ends with full penetration next to a bonfire. His friends are hooting and hollering to the sounds of sweaty, chubby bodies dully slapping together in a not quite rhythmic manner. But let's get into the lyrics, Garrett.
I hate how close your notes are to mine.
You described it too, huh?
Yeah, even down to the slapping.
Yeah. It's about all the fun things you can do with a truck at first, right? BFGs coming across the creek, Z71 headlights shining through the trees. The boys spill out of the back seat, ask me, what's it gonna be tonight? And I mean, this may as well be, you know, can you name the truck with four-wheel drive, smells like a steak and seats 35? Can you narrow?
Cigarette lighter's a lipstick holder.
12 yards long, 2 lanes wide, 65 tons of American pride. Can you narrow?
God damn it, I love that episode.
Yeah.
Tim, when I saw BFG, and despite my garbage first 20 years of life where I very much was into trucks, I was like, BFG's coming across the creek. Big Friendly Giants? Song about giants?
if you were a Doom fan, the video game, Big Fucking Gun, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a thing. But of course, no, it's BF Goodrich Tires, of course, on your Z71.
Yeah, because it's about trucks. And having fun with your buddies in trucks. Keep in mind, your boys are there, right? Your boys are present. That's going to matter later.
Go down with the boys.
Okay.
I said I'm just trying to get loose, trying to make a move. Doesn't matter what we do. As long as we're out there somewhere. Where we can go, get away from it all, get lost, and God only knows where we'll go. And hell, I don't care as long as we're out there, right? As long as you're having fun in your truck and you've given Chevy your $35,000, we're good.
Yeah, dude, welcome to 2024. Sorry, you're $50,000.
Oh, God.
So he just wants to get into the woods, just a place without judgment where men can be men. And who? God only knows what we're going to get up to.
Yeah, we should probably invite some ladies, though, you know?
Yes. I also liked the line, I said I'm just trying to get loose, trying to make a move. Don't matter what we do. If anybody, friend or even an intern in this room were with us and we were like, hey, Aaron, what do you want to do this weekend? And he replied, I'm just trying to get loose, you know, trying to make a move. Doesn't matter what we do. Aaron is not invited anymore.
Right.
Because he is shifty and up to something.
It sounds like it's coming out of Troil's mouth on some sort of weird, like it's a, we're going to do fun things, weird things, gay things. What did he say?
Cool stuff, slick stuff, neat stuff.
Yeah.
I'm totally human.
Yeah, I'm going to get loose. I'm going to make a move.
Yeah, I'm going to get loose. What's up? You know what it sounds like? It sounds like big sacks of sand. I totally hang out with the fellas on the weekend and do cool shit. I'm just, you know, guys, oh, it sounds like I love you, man.
Yeah.
Catch you on the menge. I'm sorry, what? I don't know. I don't know why I said that.
Yeah.
All right, that and other references.
We pulled in, threw it in park, and followed the orange glow in the dark and the trail marks. Through the fire and flames, we locked eyes. She walked over from the other side and smiled when I said, I'm just trying to get loose, trying to set the mood. Doesn't matter what we do. Yeah, what we do. Garrett, she is in danger.
Well, okay. On the surface, maybe. Definitely reads that way. But the spirit of the song, Tim, I'm assuming, especially with the followed the orange glow in the dark in the trail marks, I think that they were all supposed to be there. It's either some sort of mini Burning Man, which, listeners, if those are going on, invite us. That would be nice.
I disagree. I do not want to end up in a Wicker Man as Garrett did recently.
Listen, stick by my side. I know how to handle those people.
Wait, did you?
Or,
oh my God.
What's up?
Nope. I just realized why you're not.
There was an offering. There will be a bountiful harvest.
There must be an offering, though. You know about Moloch. Right.
Yeah, I heard the owl. No. Anyway, back to what we're talking about. It sounds a little bit like an orgy.
Yeah. And I mean, that's something that sometimes you do when you're, you know, your first truck. Yeah, you got some buddies. Maybe there's some girls there. Maybe there's not.
I like the idea that it's unplanned. You just stumbled onto some wood nymphs or something weird. Maybe it's those weird little elf creatures from that Somewhere Only We Know music video. God. Remember those little creeps?
So they're just
light monsters.
So he lost his soul, is what you're saying, to light monsters.
Yeah. Sort of some sort of siren situation. They lured him in. They're like, whoa, look at these weird glowing guys. And then just... soul right out of the face.
Yeah, that could have happened. But anyway, the point is he was going into this with a, listen, man, I'm going to get mine. And then fortunately, he got that soul sucked.
Yeah, clean out of him, face first. Then we get the chorus two more times, the very generic mini guitar solo. If anybody's curious, I put the music somewhere between an awful Bon Jovi meets Sloppy Train.
Yeah, that could be said about a lot of these songs, Garrett. That's a good description.
That's a theme. And that's going to bring us to track number two, Memories Are Made Of.
First taste of freedom after high school, breaking hearts.
Terrible name.
Yeah. The first part of this, it comes off quite innocent. It's a little sad. A guy's reminiscing about having fun in his teens or early 20s and kind of how his life sucks and he wished he could have those years back, right?
Yeah. If you're reminiscing about high school, aside from like when you run into a high school friend and those are the only shared conversational topics you have, like you need to get your life in order. High school is not the pinnacle.
Even then, you avert your eyes and you keep walking.
Oh, yeah. I'm talking. Oh, yeah. I mean, I didn't know we were being like that honest.
Yeah, I see people I went to high school with all the time.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's, you're either wrong or something's going on.
I don't think so. They're very successful Big Applers.
Okay, I think you're lying or mistaken or you're being like some sort of reverse Truman Showed.
Interesting. Okay,
you might be getting the gamed. I might have the gamed you on accident. I'm sorry.
The gamed me on purpose before.
Right, I might have done it on accident this time.
Interesting. Cheap boat, six packs of some light, a fireball burning up a blue sky. Mercury 93, wasn't even half past noon. Our first taste of freedom after high school, breaking hearts and curfews and mama's rules. I just laugh thinking about all the shit we got into. Yeah, those were the days we'd never lose. And again, as you're saying, I'm sure everyone had, well, hopefully people had fun in high school, but if that's the best that you did,
it shouldn't be the most fun you had.
Right. I mean, I would argue the same thing for college. A lot of people will throw that in with college. I think that that's also sad. If you met somebody in college you're still hanging out with now, your life's gone horribly awry.
Yeah, that is an excellent barometer of success. Pause for squinty stares.
Did you start a business with somebody you went to college with that makes no money and will never make money? You've made a horrible decision with your life. Why are there so many interns you have to feed?
Yeah, the intern program was supposed to make our lives easier.
I mean, in some ways it has.
Sure.
They recruit other interns. We don't have to do that anymore.
They are self-sustaining, except for when the whole crop dies out.
Hey. That made for an excellent spook house that got you out of some trouble with those goddamn record boys that came after you.
That's right. I forgot about that solution. Anyway, back to this song. Let's see here. Yeah, so he's reminiscing about wacky high school days, and of course we can all relate to this, and he thought those were days that we'd never lose. And this is where things take a turn, and I'm curious your interpretation of this, Tim, because mine, I don't think they'll be the same. He says, but we did, and we miss how it was when we were just kids. Looking back on the past wasn't much, but it was what we had. Just a couple of buds and a good buzz. That's all it was, but that's what memories are made of. What do you think? Do you think it's just the loss of, you know, childhood and free time, no responsibility?
Well, I've got a very dark theory that comes in the next verse. But interesting. I mean, at this point, I feel like it could be just still innocent. It does seem like he had a friend who was maybe more than a friend. Just a couple of buds, a good buzz. It's all it was. was. We didn't do anything out in those woods.
I see what you're saying.
When we drove our Chevys.
Drunk, Jeremy.
Yeah, when we drove our Chevys out to the bonfire, I swear to God there were women there. Right? Right?
Man, pretty hot chicks tonight, right? There were no chicks out there, Kevin. What are you talking about? Made out with like three chicks. You did not.
Got that soul sucked.
What's your job? Yeah, you were French and demons.
That's a good album name.
That's a good point. I took it as something like there was this dramatic moment in which life took a turn and all innocence was lost in that moment.
Okay. And so somebody's parents stumbled upon their bonfire and was like, hey, I'm going to tell everyone about this. None of you guys are going to college. And they said, we have to go to college. We got to do something about Mr. Johnson.
I think the song gets more specific. Let's keep going. It's been so long since me and Katie first met. We lost touch as all of the years went flying past. Fading fast, wishing I could make her mine. Let's pause right there. Now, if you read it at a glance, Tim, sure they lost touch. I think Katie might have died that summer.
Interesting.
I think maybe these buds with their good buds and a couple of suds or whatever the fuck it was. I think there was an incident. I don't know what the incident was. I don't know. But something seemingly innocent. Maybe she was sticking her car or her head out of the car window there like a dog does, doing a bit of a joke. Yeah, we all have a good joke like that. And maybe the driver was like, better stop it, Katie. Might hit a street sign. Well, little does he know, he gets a little too close and Katie loses that head of hers.
Interesting. And then, of course,
you got to bury that body and just be like, nah, I haven't seen her.
Absolutely. See, I love that theory and I think you're probably right. The way I was reading it, I felt like it turned into he's 48, he's drunk, and he's prowling around on Facebook, stalking a high school girlfriend, you know, finding out what she's up to, maybe what night of the week she has book club, and also maybe where that book club is. You know, working up the courage to, I don't know, maybe grab her. She walks to her car.
Oh, God. I thought you were going to say talk to her. Jesus. Yeah. Well, grab her.
When he sang this, in my mind, it's been so long since Katie and me first met. Lost touch. Wishing I could make her mine.
Hey, can you help me get this couch into my van?
I see your face every time I hear that. But see, that's the thing. You're right. Because wishing I could make her mine, right? Because she's no longer beheaded. There's some things that seem to take you right back anytime he gets drunk or sees a headless lady. I see her face every time I hear that Lynyrd Skynyrd bottle spin. I'm in her arms, in my mind. Yeah, those. Yeah, I think she's dead.
Yeah.
But there's a chance she's alive and he's going to get her. He's going to get her in a parking lot.
I'm going to find her. I'm going to find her and I'm going to hurt her. Let's see here. There's not much else. He did kill or will kill poor Katie. Of course, a couple more times. And then the bridge does allude to it all coming crashing down around him in a sleeper style innocent accident. When he says, yeah, those were the days we thought we'd never lose. Of course he did. Track number three, Lonely One.
Out to curse his name and have a few.
Slowing it down a bit, and I don't like it.
No, absolutely not. This one's more sinister than the last, I think.
Yeah, it is.
So it's about a bartender, right?
Sure.
But I feel like it's about a bartender that specifically took the day shift, a shift no one wants, because it tends to be low traffic and poor tips, so everyone was fine to let him have it, but he knows that's when the saddest, the most pathetic women come in, therefore the most vulnerable, and that's when he is able to get what Garrett calls that sweet snooze.
Oh my God.
Because they're vulnerable, you see.
To be clear, the only part he's quoting or attributing to me is sweet, sweet sniz, which I'm not cool with, but I'll take.
Honey, how's that drink going down? Seems a little stiff for 2 p.m. Holler if you need anything. I've got an ear to lend. I'll be right here cutting limes, counting cash, and stocking beers. I've got an idea of what's on your mind. So in the meantime, think on this. Yeah, so he's observing his prey.
I mean, there's no other way to read it.
Right, right. This is the sort of bar where, listen, it's got kind of a reputation where women go missing from this a lot.
But that
it also kind of is like a little bit of its allure. It's a dangerous place. No one can really pin it on anyone. Why would it be somebody that works there? Who would be that stupid? He's basically using the basic instinct defense.
Also, if you're going to do a bunch of sad day drinking, you don't want to go to a place where you might run into Cheryl from yoga class.
Absolutely. You want to go to the place where there were all those murders. murders happened. That way, you know, nobody you know is going to be there.
Is there like a tip jar or something? No, we take our tips a different way.
Jesus.
You getting drunk yet? God.
He's just fucking with me. I know it, but like, still don't. Like, it's so weird.
Jesus Christ. Anyway, I've seen girls like you in here before. Watched broken hearts break through that door a time or two. And I'll bet he packed all his things. You set out to curse his name and have a few. And I'll bet you're doing your best to move on. Well, you're not the only lonely one.
Right. And here's where it takes its turn, right? He gets it. She isn't the only one that's been hurt, right? He's been hurt too, so why not throw a little bit of that sad sniz old Luke's way? How about that, hun? You know,
I get listeners, write in hatepodmail@gmail.com. I've been a waiter multiple places for multiple years. No patron is trying to bang the waiter.
No, but sometimes bartenders.
That's my question. hatepodmail@gmail.com. Are the bartenders banging the patrons? They gotta be, right?
Sometimes.
I will say the bartenders and the waiters and waitresses are all banging each other. It's crazy.
Well,
but
well, at least they were in 98.
2003 to I'm old. 2001. They were. 02. I was a waiter at
Uno's.
They're
all trying
Uno's
to comfort
pizzeria.
Themselves from 9/11. I get it. We're all sad.
Anyway, I'm curious. Write in. Please don't dear penthouse us. I'm just asking for objective facts. Do you end up banging the customers a lot? And are you taking advantage of the fact that they're drunk?
Don't write in for that last part either way.
Yeah, that second part's a goof. I hope that's not true.
Either way. Anyway. Don't need to know. Don't want to know.
Oh, yeah. So he's hitting on her. Hey, you're not the only one that's lonely. Right. Song continues. This ain't my first rodeo. I've seen the other side of this bar. Pouring salts on an open wound. Sitting right there where you are. Tim, do you think bartenders ever come into work on their day off and drink at the bar they work at?
Absolutely not. That's something only a sitcom would have you believe. The only possible way that happens is if they get free drinks there.
Interesting. HeyPodMail@gmail.com. Is Tim completely wrong? I don't know. I'm not taking you aside. I'm just saying. It'd be nice to hear if you were completely wrong.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, listen, if we were both bartenders somewhere and it was my day off and you were working, I would absolutely come in there and be an asshole.
Yeah, that's different. That's a friend coming in to ruin your day at work. That's that's a time-honored tradition among friends. I don't know why we do it, but we do, and it's funny. Your job is like an amusement park to me because I don't have to be there and you do.
Right.
Anyway.
Please stop doing
this
that.
This ain't my first rodeo. I already read that. I'm sorry. I've seen him come and I've seen him go. Girl, you ain't in this thing alone. Oh no. Oh no.
Again, it
when
has
he
this...
says he's seen him come and go. Does that just mean he's been a bartender a long time, or does he have like an MO?
Yeah, he's got an
first
MO.
First they come,
he cures all their woes with his penis.
I'm gonna take the pain away. I'm gonna take the pain away. It's the last thing they hear as they slip into unconsciousness. That's horrible.
Ugh.
Yeah, your words, not mine.
His paraphrased word. These are his sentiments, allegedly. Don't be disgusted with us, especially not me. If you have to be disgusted with one of us, make it Garrett.
I guess so, but I'm kind of doing a Mickey Rourke thing.
Yeah, yeah, you are. And I know it probably stings right now, somehow more than Jim Beam, but that clock on the wall will cure it all, even though that ain't how it seems, right? Time heals all wounds. However, time isn't as good at healing wounds as revenge sex with a bartender, right? Maybe, what if we film it and send it to your ex? Maybe we just film it and don't send it to anyone. Maybe just think about it. Point is, if you're sad and I don't get tipped, you're sad, I don't get tipped, this is going to happen, right?
Nothing's going to chap your boyfriend's ass like having sex with old Lukey. Yeah, face of a dog, body of a cat. It's disturbing. Get over here. Oh, yeah. I've been the revenge guy more than once. You're not going to offend me. I know the rules. No kissing. Trying to keep the face back. I get it. I get it. And I am down. Yeah, this is like 85% of the tail I pull. Please don't call me tail.
It just sounds so natural coming from you.
Oh, gross. Let's move on. Track number 4, beer can.
But here comes a few days of unpaid
vacation. Which, of course, starts with the sound of a beer can opening. Always a good sign.
Yeah, this could easily be an Aerosmith song until he actually starts singing.
Right.
It is bad.
It's just about how he's an alcoholic.
It is. Well, yes. Spoiler alert. Yes, it 100% is. But it is. They really pull the rug out from under me, Tim. Because up till now, he's been a bit of a miscreant. He's at the bar hunting women. That's not a good guy. And I hear beer can. I'm like, Jesus Christ. Now we're going to talk about the celebration of just guys getting hammered. But he begins. I've been working this job 9 to 5. Minimum wage and overtime. But here comes a few days of unpaid vacation. And there ain't no way, Jose, I'll waste them. Because there ain't no better feeling than when. And I'm like, all right, here's a hard-working American man getting a few unpaid days off, which I thought was an odd way to refer to a weekend, but it's fine. Seems like a little bit of a manipulation, but I'm going to let it go.
Honestly, I
love that he worked in No Way Jose.
Yeah, I assumed he got fired here from his job for alcoholism.
Yes. And so up to this point, I'm like, all right, I'm with this guy. Everybody's working for the weekend. And then he says that I'll reread that very last line so that everyone gets the full impact. Because there ain't no better feeling than when I pick up a beer can and get to feeling like Superman. It's Friday night, y'all. Here's the plan. I'm going to throw back a couple and keep them glued to my right hand, any flavor, size, or brand, until the point where I can't stand. No, nothing picks me up like a beer can.
Yes. Now, it's not so much for me that he's drinking to the point that he can't stand. I've got no problem with that. We've all done that. It's honestly pretty cool.
Any flavor or brand, Garrett.
Yeah.
Corona?
What, are you just going to put Heineken?
Yeah. White Claw, Smirnoff Ice, Garrett. This is fucking disgusting. Are you 12?
Tequiza?
If you're 12, it's fine. If you're an adult, I don't care if your job is minimum wage. Any flavor, any brand, absolutely not. Even if it's free.
Any flavor, any brand, it's child's play. It's ridiculous. It's the indication of a serious drinking problem is what it is.
Yeah, absolutely. More so than anything else seen in this song. Now, he continues, right? So we've established that he's a bit of an alcoholic and basically he's just sitting at that job or presumably on that roof, just tapping his foot, waiting until the weekend or whatever.
Just waiting for permission, Tim.
Right, right.
I do like that he says, makes me feel like Superman. You know what I love about drinking? It makes me feel invincible.
It does. It really does.
If you're sitting next to somebody who says that, just get out. That evening ends in like overturned couches, possibly an arrest, possibly an escaped arrest.
That evening ends with Katie being beheaded out the window of your car.
Look at me, I'm a dog. Better stop, Katie. Whoa!
It's a much louder
noise
than that.
On that day, we all became adults.
Absolutely. Garrett, verse 2 is the point in the song where I had a bit of a revelation. I woke up at 1 p.m. and introduced myself to my new girlfriend, and there's a wrecking ball-sized hole in the wall of the basement. I ain't got no clue how or who could have made it. All I know is the shit hit the fan, and here we go again. Now, Garrett, you know me. I used to drink. I sometimes used to drink and go to Nashville. Garrett, I made that hole. I drank with Luke Combs, and I smashed a hole on his wall. It was not the basement.
It's interesting. Well, he's allowed artistic license. I don't mind that. Were you doing with him? I don't know if this is just something with my friends, but did you ever have friends, Tim, that like they had their drunk thing? Maybe we've talked about this.
Yes.
Like whenever they get like one guy just runs away. There's that guy.
Yeah. Sometimes you walk down the hall punching roof tiles out of Towers dormitory. Well, I outlived you, Towers. You're gone now. I'm still here.
Yeah. It was raised. Mm. Anyway. What was I saying? Right. So your thing is your thing reenacting the music video to Miley Cyrus's Wrecking Ball.
Absolutely not. My thing's ending up in Nashville.
Okay.
Which it was is just how a coincidence. I know Luke Combs.
I see. But the Wrecking Ball sized hole in his home and our home, coincidence.
Absolutely not, Garrett. I also host a music podcast with Luke Combs. And when we did our Miley Cyrus episode, I did the same thing. It was exactly 1 week before I did the episode with you. I think we did a better job. I have much better chemistry with you than him. I barely know him.
He doesn't know we're doing the episode.
I'm just talking about music, recording.
I'm screaming bits at him as he's shoving me out of his house. Yeah,
he's
a terrible
very drunk.
Podcast
yeah.
host.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he's waking up at 1 p.m. after a blackout. You know, I'll give you credit here, Tim, or maybe I shouldn't now after you've revealed that you're the source of multiple large holes in people's homes, at least you have the audacity to brag about your destruction. This man blacks out and wakes up to destruction he created and goes, I don't know what happened.
Well, he really doesn't know what happened. He wasn't even home at the time.
Oh, Jesus.
I do love...
Never mind.
What I love about this verse, though, is, I mean, you've seen him, right? And listen, no offense to him.
It sounds like this will be, like, deeply offensive. Go on.
He paints himself as quite the ladies' man, and I don't believe it.
I'm sure he is now.
Sure. This is his first album, Garrett. Also, I think he's happily married with several children. He wrote that Father's Day album, Garrett. It wasn't about his father. It was to make his children celebrate him, I believe.
Weird.
It is. Yeah, you're right.
Well, it's Sunday now, and I'm freaking out because I can't handle 5 days without. And then he sings about beer some more. That is not good.
Yeah, he's got the DTs. But here's something that I think I can really change his life around. You can drink moderately on weekdays.
Yeah.
No, I don't know if he can, but one can.
Yeah. I mean, the song would give you the indication that he cannot.
Yeah.
More of an all or nothing sort of fellow.
Aren't we all?
Aren't we all? Track number 5, Hurricane.
You're rolling with your hair in the wind, baby, without warning.
So this was the song that made him.
Huh?
Yeah, like this was that first single. This was the first, his first number one single. It was his first real single. This was the one that basically got him signed.
Well, I'll be.
And that's the right reaction, because why?
I mean, who knows, right? None of this is for me. I can't fathom why people like any of this garbage. But the song starts with like a serious tone, and then that just kind of goes away. It's so strange to me how generic these songs become, but let's get into the lyrics, because this is maybe one of the meatiest songs, as far as lyrics go, of the whole album, which sang a lot. He says, hadn't had a good time since you know when. Got talked into going out with hopes you were staying in. I was feeling like myself for the first time in a long time, until I bumped into some of your friends over there talking to mine. Pretty obvious. He and this lady used to go out. They're no longer going out, and it's really got him messed up, Tim. He finally gets himself pulled together. He's going to go out with his boys, as you like to say.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, he knows, her friends are here, which of course is a arbiter of things to come. But I'm curious right off the bat, do you think he broke up with her or she broke up with him?
She definitely broke up with him.
Disagree.
Really? Okay.
Yes. I started in your camp, but there's a couple of things that make me think it's the opposite. I'm excited to maybe bring you onto my side, or maybe you can prove me wrong. Happy to go either way. Let's get into it. So we at least agree they broken up. He's got himself back on his feet. He's going out for the first time, and fuck beans. She's probably going to be there.
Right.
Then you rolled in with your hair in the wind, baby, without warning. I was doing all right, but just your sight had my heart storming. The moon went hiding, stars quit shining, rain was driving, thunder lightning. You wrecked my whole world when you came in. You hit me like a hurricane. Like a hurricane.
You're so stupid.
So, as predicted, she's come in. It has ruined his whole evening and apparently altered weather and astrology and astronomy.
Astrology. You had it right.
Yeah. And astronomy. I think it might be too early. Okay. So here's the first indication that I think that maybe he broke up with her is that when she comes in, he's instantly concerned. See, at first I assumed he was concerned that like, oh, I'm going to start crying again. And I can't hit on other women if she's in the room. I think he is scared to be in the same room with her because he cannot say no. And it took everything he had to break up with her. And he's like, fuck, if she's here, I'm going to go home with her.
Yeah, I think that's true. But I have a slightly different twist on this.
Fucked up.
Sort of. I mean, well, we'll get into it, right? Knew it was going to be a long night from the moment when we locked eyes over whiskey on ice. Started talking about us again. If I would have just laid my drink down and walked out, I wouldn't be in my truck driving us to your house. I like to think that she is some sort of weird siren or possibly just an ex who hates him, right? Maybe he did break up with her, Garrett. Or maybe she broke up with him. Doesn't really matter. But she hates him and she is bent on destroying.
Maybe, how about this? She broke up with him right before he got that first single, this song, or a whatever, you know, but right before he got signed, right? And so she's real pissed off. And so she hates him and is bent on destroying his life as completely as she can, right? So she just shows up every now and then, anytime he's going to do something important or meaningful, right? Like the night before he was supposed to sign that record deal, she just happens to be there. Hey, want to maybe take me home? He wakes up 3 hours late. She's out of his life for another 6 months until coincidentally he's about to get married to the actual love of his life. And she just shows up to that bachelor party to ruin one of
just life's- to say hi Absolutely. And let you know there's no hard feelings.
Right, right. And then, you know, she disappears again only to show up drunk at the christening of his son. His father and son's album is playing and
I still love you.
Right, like a fucking hurricane.
God, yours is good. I like that. I like that. Mine was that he had to break up with her because she was such a bad influence that he ends up doing super crazy shit and his life turns into a Category 5 hurricane.
Oh, I like that too.
Yeah, it's partially, you know, it's on a backbone of heavy drinking as illustrated by many other songs on this album.
All the other songs.
But it's
songs.
Also the activity that happens afterwards.
Yeah.
She's like one of those ladies that likes to tell other men that her boyfriend's going to kick their ass.
Oh, yeah. We've discussed this. Yeah.
Yeah. Nobody likes that guy. Let's see. A Category 5 with your smile blew me away. And girl, it ain't but midnight. You done killed the lights. Bent my heart back to your bedside. So he's back in there. It worked. She lures him in before midnight. And then he's back on board with the lies and the drinking and the shoplifting and graffiti tagging.
Yeah. We've all been there.
That'd be weird. What if you had like a full-grown adult spouse that was just super into graffiti?
Is he or she super good at it?
Yeah. Yeah. Very good at it.
So I'm married but, like, to Banksy.
No, not that good. Oh. Yeah, why was it with you and just like 0 to 1,000? Not the best. I didn't say the best. Just somebody who's good, but they only like to tag.
Okay. And they're, but like their tag is like very obviously it's a reference to you. So the police always come to you.
Who is this Terry Chardson? They become a scourge on the city of Manhattan.
Oh yeah, and then one of them looks at it sideways. Oh my god. T.E. Richardson. I know that guy.
Listeners, write in hatepodmail@gmail.com. What are you tagging Terry Chardson in your city?
Oh, definitely do that. I mean,
yeah,
allegedly.
Don't, but
right.
You if know, you, whatever listen, legally, listen, like, we're not thing. Telling you to do it.
You could be writing gang signs on things, and I'm saying don't do that. If you are already going to be graffitoing things. Is that the right word?
Nailed it.
Okay, great, great. If you're already going to be graffitoing things, why not write Terry Chardson?
Jeez, Terry. Track number 6. One number away.
I'm one number away from calling you. I said I was through, but I'm done.
So the intro to this one, it sounds like it's going to be about some old-time outlaw. Like we're thinking like Dead or Alive. But it just couldn't be further from that.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a sad song about a sad man.
It's just more sad boy bullshit. But it sounds really funny because it's not only is it sad boy bullshit, but it's outdated now and it feels like a teenager talking about wanting to talk on the phone a bunch or something. It's
oh yeah, this is super 90s emo-y.
Yeah, it's tough. He says, are you sitting at home all alone trying to fall asleep? Are you staring a hole through your phone praying that it rings? Are you watching a movie that you've seen 1,000 times or maybe playing some Mayor getting lost in your favorite lines?
When he says that, this is the kind of guy who has a ton of favorite Mayor lines and they're obscure Mayor lines and he wants to talk to you to see if your favorite Mayor lines are the same as his favorite Mayor lines and if you're a true fan.
Ugh. Oh, that sounds exhausting.
He's exhausting.
With giant hands. That's for the old time listeners, folks. You're welcome. So yeah, they broke up. Maybe it's our couple from the previous song. He finally broke away from her again and instantly he regrets it. He likes the taste of the adrenaline, the wild sex, the obsessive drinking, the graffitoing. But he's staying away. He knows he can't be out there tagging in his 40s. And so he's at home watching his favorite movies, listening to some JM. And I think, Tim, these are all texts
texts that are being sent as feelers.
Ooh.
Trying to figure things out. Taking the temp of the room. Trying to figure out if she's maybe feeling what he's feeling.
I like the idea that he wrote this song and then somebody broke up with him or he broke up with somebody and he is now texting the lyrics of his own songs to them as if they won't notice.
Honestly, it'd be hilarious if they didn't. let's see. Well, if you're anything like me, you just might be doing whatever it takes to drown out the noise, but I just want to hear your voice. So he's at home, sad, crying, blasting train, doing shots, and he just keeps staring at the phone, thinking about calling her.
Yeah.
We've all been there.
I like the way he phrases it as if she also feels the same way, but there's never any indication that she does.
No, not at all. That's why he has to text it to her, and every one of these ends in a question mark. It's just not in our... I'm one number away from calling to you. I said I was through, but I'm dying inside. Got my head in a mess. Girl, I confess, I lied when I said I'm leaving and not coming back. Sounds a lot like it might be our couple from the previous song. And then I was trying to figure out, Tim, in this modern age, because he is a good 6-7 years younger than I am. Wow, what is he talking about dialing phone numbers? Maybe, Tim, to finally rid himself of the succubus, he deleted her phone number. Mm-hmm. Which is a rookie move. You should always rename that phone number to do not answer.
Absolutely.
And so he keeps dialing the number back into his phone minus that one last digit. Just thinking about, should he do it? Or he is a psychopathic killer and has a landline.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I am imagining he's some sort of Philip Seymour Hoffman from that movie you're super into where he calls the ladies.
He calls the ladies.
Yeah. He calls them and he's, you know, breathes heavily.
No?
What are you talking about? Todd Stoltz or whatever his name is.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Sunshine? Is it Sunshine?
Oh.
He masturbates on the
phone. Todd Solondz.
Solondz. Yeah, there you go.
Oh, God. Seems like you're real into it, just to be clear.
I don't remember his name.
But you remembered literally everything else.
Yeah. You made me watch that movie twice.
It's pretty good.
Okay. Yeah, he's super into it. All right.
All right. Song continues. Might be the whiskey or the midnight rain, but everywhere I go, I see your face. Those don't rhyme. In my brain, dial it up. Everything I want to say, but I'm still one number away. Now, he is having a drunk walk in the rain, and that's always going to lead to mistakes.
Disagree. That always leads to some sort of, I don't know, daredevil like situation, and that's pretty cool.
No, it won't. Why do you think that would be the case?
Ninjas
is your answer.
The possibility of ninjas. Yes, I stand by it.
All right. Well, my experience with a drunk walk in the rain ends with somebody accidentally breaking a candle in a pharmacy and having to fake a mental disability to get out of paying for it because they don't have enough money.
You were not drunk.
Okay. Are you stuck at a red light with a Marlboro light on your lips? Does the smoke in the mirror get clearer without my kiss? Are you changing the station, replacing our favorite songs? Well, maybe it's a mistake. Hit the brakes on this moving on. Maybe she only smoked and listened to country music because she was with him. And now that she's quit him, she's quit smoking and it's all John Mayer for her. Maybe there's a shot at the beginning of the song.
Oh.
I know you, Lisa. You're probably just at home crying and listening to John Mayer.
Maybe
it's something they enjoyed together.
Crying and Mayer. I get it.
What are you guys doing this weekend? We're just gonna have a good cry and listen to some John Mayer.
Oh. Yeah, I get it. I think the bridge, will you pick up when I call or just forget we loved it all? We don't have to talk. I just want to hear your voice. I assume he's just calling her voicemail to hear her voice.
Mostly. I assume this is all over text and it's like an agreement so that he'll stop texting her. He's like, just pick up. You don't have to talk. Just listen to me. I just want to hear you breathe.
Right.
Just breathe into the phone, Melissa.
Philip Seymour Hoffman from that movie you love.
Yes.
Did you watch the music video by chance?
No.
All right. Well, spoilers for those of you that would like to watch the music video, go do that now. I will spoil it. The lady is definitely driving to see him after they got in a fight, but then like a goddamn overly dramatic after school special, she is killed in a car wreck.
What?
So it is somebody just calling the voicemail and weeping.
Track number 7. Don't tell me. For a second that I can't hang, 'cause I've been known to get this
song is a story of that just awful friend that he kind of grew up, right? It's the Will Ferrell character from Old School, if anyone in our audience is old enough to have seen Old School. It's somebody that's white-knuckled it a couple years into responsibility, but is just barely hanging on in the slightest breeze. He's going streaking, and then there's going to be a slew of DUIs.
It's just all going to come tumbling down.
Yeah.
It definitely speaks to more aggressive alcoholism.
Yeah.
It's, I guess I'll just say it up top so everybody's got the right picture in their mind. It's the guy who says, don't tease me. If we're drinking, we're drinking. And you're just like, I don't know the distinction you're making, but no.
I do, and no.
Just, I don't understand why, never mind. Like, it's people who are just looking for permission to be psychopaths because that's what they want to be. Okay, he says, I've been doing my best to make church on Sundays. I ain't been calling in hungover most Mondays. I guess you could say I'm
most
being grown up.
Most Mondays. More than 50% of Mondays. 27 weeks of the year, I did not call in hungover on Monday.
You got to be careful, otherwise they might start figuring it out.
Fun thing, you don't actually have to call in, right? Like, I assume he's calling in sick. You just go in hungover or just don't show up.
Well, if you don't show up, I think you get fired.
Not if you've got like an office with a door that closes. A lot of times people just assume you're in there.
I take wrapping paper tubes and I put pants on them. Because you can only see under my desk. You can't see the top part. And I just crisscross them with a pair of shoes. I haven't been to the office in 2 years.
Right, because you've lived in the Big Apple with me.
Correct. Let's see. So it sounds like this guy's got his act together. I got my shit together, and oddly enough, I don't mind because it's about time. So he realizes he wasted a bunch of years. He celebrated any old beer. He's out there drinking Tequiza or Red Dog or other beers that aren't made anymore. Bud Ice? Are we still making Bud Ice, America?
They make non-alcoholic Heineken. I found that out in Philadelphia. I assume that's an exclusive product to Philadelphia to trick them into drinking just slightly less. They're animals.
Would you
Garrett.
Like me to make this worse?
They're animals. Honestly, yeah, it made it better there.
Yeah. Just one less drunk.
Yes.
Okay.
But he's anytime, right? Because if you're second guessing, don't think for a second that I can't hang. Because I've been known to get a little wild and reckless, known to have a little bit of beer with breakfast. You can bet these boots have gotten pretty used to stomping on a hardwood floor and buying the bar another round of shots. Close my tab, hit the parking lot. Next stop is a spot with a fridge stocked on the back porch.
Let's get the last two out. I ain't afraid to step too many steps out of line, so don't tempt me with a good time. Okay.
He just needs an excuse.
Just give me a reason. Yeah, I definitely... Also, I've been known to have a little bit of beer with breakfast. How low of a bar is it that you think... Like, the whole opening to this song was how much he had his shit together. How not together was his shit before this?
Right, and here's the thing. If you're that much of an alcoholic, beer's already gone. That's out the window.
Yeah.
That's not gonna get you drunk.
Or sober, or not shaking, or whatever you define that as.
Right. Yeah, you got a little... It's gotta be at least 60 to 70 proof.
I mean, at that point, you're doing it purely actually as medication, so it's probably grain alcohol.
I mean, technically, it is medication.
At that point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jesus, this is a dark episode. Luke McCombs, what have you done? Let's see. He goes on.
Well, most folks think I don't know how to throw down. They done forgot about Rowdy. But no doubt he's still around, so keep cracking those jokes, because I'm willing and able. Yeah, this old boy will drink you under the table. I love that he has some sort of weird alter ego known as Rowdy that people know him as. Right, because for them to have forgotten, they must have been, oh shit, Rowdy's here.
Luke's gone. Oh, you done fucked up now.
Yes.
Rowdy's here. Oh, God damn it. It's not like, okay, so you and I used to know a guy. I will have to bleep this, but this is for you. Maybe you didn't know. I don't know. He was older than me. And he was the nicest person I've ever met. And occasionally, not even often, occasionally he'd get really drunk. And out would come his alter ego, Easton O. White. And he was a psychopath. Just the worst ideas. All of them at once, simultaneously. And the rest of the time you knew him. And like, he wasn't one of these guys that got hammered every weekend. It was like a once a semester, Easton O. White came out. And Jesus Christ. Terrifying man. But
I like the idea that it's not like that. It's
no, he literally turns into Rowdy
Piper.
There it is.
But I'm gonna give him a bonesaw voice because that's more fun to me. Bonesaw is ready. Never not funny. Anyway, it's a shame the most people have not found the feed because I'm doing the hands, the smile, all of it, gang. It's just for Tim. Anyway, I'm thinking it's possibly Tony Clifton level commitment.
Excellent.
Like only referred to as Rowdy, possibly like, let's pretend for a moment, Luke and his buddies are drinking at a barbecue and somebody shoves Luke and Luke shoves him back and they have a bit of a toss about and maybe that other fella shoved Luke just a bit too far or a bit too hard and he tripped over a chair. Not a big deal, but loses some face. Nobody thinks twice about it. Luke goes inside, full costume change, comes out bandana, wraparound glasses, tearaway tank. Rowdy's here! Now we're gonna drink.
Do you think Rowdy will be seen after Luke Combs is definitely dead?
Yes, but it will be Luke Combs, not what's his face. Song continues. It's 3 a.m. I'm still hanging tough. My buddy's passed out in the bed of my truck. I can't wait till he wakes up and sees the pictures on his phone. Tim, what's on that phone?
Okay, there's two different things that's possible. One.
Only one if I'm in that truck.
Bunch of dicks, right? Well, there's three.
I prefer taints and assholes.
Okay, sure. Taints, assholes, or, you know, maybe just one specific taint and asshole, but from a bunch of different vantage points.
Yeah, angles and lighting and, like, moods.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe he's doing a Cartman, you know, where his buddy opens his photos the next day and sees a hilarious picture where his dick's in Luke's mouth and Luke is smiling and giving a thumbs up. And that's how you know his buddy is gay now. You know,
it's one of the funniest episodes ever.
Yeah, it's always also fun just to take photos of strangling victims that you just happen to come across on a good friend's phone and just never address it.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and you know, maybe somebody else sees those photos on there and just makes an assumption and then you're off scot-free. That guy's going down for that.
I am always watching you.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, I got tapes on tapes.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Track number 8.
I have the unedited versions of this show.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, fuck yeah, you do.
I have more unedited versions.
Looks like the detente continues. And that's how it's done, folks. Track number 8, When It Rains, It Pours.
And I want $100 on a scratch-off ticket ball to
20. Hate everything that Luke Combs likes. This is the song that really made me think that he is a real Stephen King. Again, did we believe it? Probably not.
Who could care? That guy sucks.
Yeah, his girlfriend leaves him because he got drunk or pissed in the bed or whatever. Sunday morning, man, she woke up fighting mad, bitching and moaning on and on about the time I had. And by Tuesday, you could say the girl was good as gone. Then when Thursday came around, I was all alone. So I went for a drive to clear my mind, ended up at a Shell on I-65.
It almost certainly is that fellow we just heard about in the last song. You don't get it, babe. They said I couldn't hang. I'm sorry, what? We have two children.
Right, but they said Rowdy can't hang. Do I need to do the voice?
Cheryl, you don't understand. They said I couldn't hang and that Rowdy is bullshit. One guy said Rowdy wasn't even real. God damn it, Luke. Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah. So she is completely legitimately angry at him and left him. And so he decides to go driving aimlessly down the highway like some sort of strangler.
As one does. But Garrett, his luck changes. He gets that sweet, sweet lottery ticket. Bet she's jealous now. Then I won $100 on a scratch-off ticket. I bought 2 12-packs and a tank of gas with it. She swore they were a waste of time. Oh, but she was wrong.
Gloat about this.
Yeah, this is so sad. It is a waste of time. Those of you buying scratch-off tickets, stop it.
Who doesn't have a job now, Marilyn? Still you. You just have a scratch-off.
Scratch-off job. I was caller number 5 on the radio station. Won a 4-day, 3-night beach vacation. Deep sea senorita fishing down in Panama. And I ain't gotta see my ex-future mother-in-law anymore. Oh Lord, when it rains, it pours. So he got the equivalent of, I don't know, a couple $1,000 worth of vacation, and he gets to go bang Central American hookers?
Yeah, that part was unclear. I thought it might be some sort of stripper deep sea fishing. I think he's fishing for the senoritas.
Right, but at the whorehouse.
Well, they're guaranteed. They're in a barrel, Tim.
Right, as one does. It's why
the whorehouse is the barrel.
Right, it's why the deep sea is so ironic. That's what makes this a good song. The
listeners, write in. What's the formal vernacular for whorehouse? Prostitutiversity?
Mm.
Oh, it is cat house. Can it be prostitutiversity?
It can. I mean, they've got to learn somewhere, right?
I guess so. I mean, there's probably a lot of tricks of the trade.
Right. And you'd want to, I mean, you want to teach those up front, I would assume.
I mean, if I had to guess, you want to get it done as fast as possible. So if somebody could tell you how to make it happen, you'd probably be wanting to know.
The sex.
Yeah.
All right. Verse number two. Now, she was sure real quick to up and apologize when she heard about my newfound luck on that FM dial. It's crazy.
Oh, hold on. We can't yet. She wants to reconcile the marriage because you want a timeshare trip.
See,
I don't think so. I think he doesn't get sarcasm.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he called her and she was like, oh yeah, that sounds great. You had sex with those hulas.
Yeah, great job, Carl. $100 on a scratch off and a trip to Panama City. Our problems are solved.
Oh, do you think it's Panama City?
Oh, that's even better.
Delightful.
Probably. Read the fine print. You're going to a city in Florida. Enjoy.
Yeah. So my thought was the only way that this would actually make sense is if the luck she was hearing about on the FM dial was his song on the radio.
Mm.
Not that he won a stupid radio contest, but
I'm pretty sure it's about winning $100 scratch off in a radio contest. Also, if you have the free time to call into a radio contest in the 2000s, you need to just go ahead and kill yourself. No, that's too extreme. Get a job. You need to get a job and better hobbies and learn about MP3 players.
Right, right. I mean, it can't be the fact that he's got songs on the radio, because otherwise he would have enough money that the rest of this good luck stuff isn't what he would be bragging about, right?
Yeah, no, he's bragging about things no one should brag about. This is a song about the worst guy in the world not getting that his life is awful.
Yes. It's crazy how lately now it just seems to come in waves. What I thought was going to be the death of me was my saving grace. It's got me thinking that her leaving is the only logical reason, and then blah, blah, blah. But you're right, it is such a sad ambition, right? I got the last spot in the Hooters parking lot, and the waitress left her number on my check with a heart. She picked up on the first ring when I gave her a call, and I only spent $5 at the Moose Club raffle, won a used four-wheeler and 3 free passes for me and 2 of my buddies to play a round of golf, and I ain't gotta see my mother-in-law anymore.
Yeah, okay, again, and listen, I'm not against free rounds of golf. I'm not against a used four-wheeler. I enjoy recreational vehicles.
It's weird that he specifies that it's used, right?
That is a little strange. But like, all this story seems to be about is this guy making all of the worst decisions possible. Of course he's at Hooters. And do you think maybe it's like the John Lovitz liar character? And then I got the last spot at Hooters, see? And the waitress, yeah. She gave me her number and I called her and she answered on the first ring. Yeah, that's the ticket. Because this doesn't make any sense to brag about, and most of it sounds like a lie. Hooters restaurant employees, write in hatepodmail@gmail.com. Are you ever seeking the physical attraction of any of the patrons of your restaurant? I can't imagine.
No, but they are banging the cooks, I think.
Well, yes, they're in a restaurant.
Right, okay. We've
established. Well, there's a pecking order. The cooks are selling them weed. The waitresses are, but there's no waiters there.
Right.
Maybe the hosts? No, they're hostesses too. Yeah. I've only been to Hooters like twice.
Yeah, this guy's going often enough. He's got a favorite parking spot, I think.
Yikes. A VIP spot?
Ew. Track number 9. This one's for you.
Yeah, I told you all I'd write you a song.
Good news. We're slowing things down again.
Yeah, this is, for
we're
my
gonna
money.
Blow through this.
Yeah, this is probably the most boring song on the album for me. People in his life previously have helped him out. Some of them have supported him. It's true for everyone, but he's grateful. And that's this song.
Yeah, I think hundreds of people in his life over time have both contributed to and supported him. And they've also said, if you ever want to write a song about me, go ahead.
Well, okay. That's the only interesting part of this song, right? The chorus. It goes... I told you all I'd write a song. Song, song, song. Pour my heart in the melody to keep you singing along, singing along, singing along. This may not be the right time. These may not be the right lines to prove for saying what I'm trying to, but this one's for you. I like that this is purely transactional, right? I said,
now
okay.
Stop asking.
I borrowed money from you, and I said, as a result, I would write a song for you as a thank you. Now this, I have done that. This is that, right? This is the meal, Jerry.
Soup's not a meal.
Yeah.
I didn't tell you what to order.
I have done that, right? We're even, I'm not paying you back. This is the payment.
Yeah. It's a song thanking you about you. What else did you want? It's almost verbatim what I told you I would do.
Yeah. It's
a plural you.
I discussed this with a lawyer and he said this qualifies.
Yeah. He actually called me quite clever for it.
Yeah.
I probably shouldn't have told you that part. Yeah. Fuck this. Track number 10. Be careful what you wish for.
Don't know what you got till it's gone and you're out on your own. All you want is what you can't get back.
Garrett, I'm back on board for this song, if only briefly, because the rest of this album is trash.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, I mean, this is a tale as old as time. Couldn't wait to ride out of this one-horse town. Didn't see no use in sticking around. I was green and busting at the seams to leave. I was sitting on G, waiting on O. Not an expression.
The day an expression I hit 18, we've all used, friends.
You in a hurry? Well, you could say I'm sitting on G and waiting on O.
Well, obviously not.
What?
If you had the time to say that, you idiot.
Yeah, that's a mouthful, sir. Also, it's a long way to walk for, quite honestly, what I would say is something inarguably not catchy. The day I hit 18, I hit the road. Traded that country maintain for a four-lane city road. You know, country mouse wanting to escape to the big city, get out there, make a name for himself, blah, blah, blah.
Right. But then, Garrett, is the turn. But sometimes things ain't what you think they're gonna be. What you want ain't always what you need. Garrett, he thought he was gonna go to the big city, Nashville, of course, to be a star, but that's not how you make it in this town. Sure, you're dressed like a cowboy. Sure, you can sing. But there are plenty of singers in this town. Garrett, if you want to make it, you're going to need to do something no one else can or is willing to do. Luke Combs, Nashville Gigolo, Sundays on HBO.
I mean, I was going to say this has a very Midnight Cowboys vibe.
Yeah, and it's great.
That movie's really good.
Yeah, this song decidedly less so, but it still is definitely about how he had to whore himself out before he got that record contract.
I mean, at least poor little John Voight in that movie gets to whore himself out to the ladies. That was
I don't think
that would actually go. God, it's been a minute since I've seen
just
that.
Just the first one.
Interesting.
Ratso.
That movie.
It's got a great soundtrack. I have it on vinyl.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
I'm going to take that and replace it with a laser disc of Godzilla.
Excellent.
Okay. Here's all you really ought to, all you really need to know. You don't know what you got till it's gone and you're out on your own. All you want is what you can't get back. Once you let it go, then you know what you have. Don't hold a candle to what you had. Sometimes what you think you'll find, it ain't quite what real life has in store. So be careful what you wish for. I do not think anyone's gonna beat Joni Mitchell's Big Yellow Taxi. So let's all just stop with the don't know what you got till it's gone. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's off the table. Can't sing about. Luke Combs, we're gonna strike it from the album.
Fair enough.
This song sucks.
Yeah, but it is kind of fun because it's about the, you know, Midnight Cowboy of it all. Because
these city lights can't shine quite like the stars. I wish I could wish her back into my arms.
Right, instead of this man. This man who's intent on making love to me.
Instead of this city, Tim. This city is making love to him. In the form of a series of endless, nameless, faceless men.
Track number 11, I Got Away With You.
Crazy truth.
This is just a song bragging about a kidnapping. Well, I got caught in Panama City trying to buy some beer for some Georgia girls.
Jesus Christ. Here's the thing. Listen. You are absolutely a hero to the children you buy beer from. Don't tell anyone about it. It's a weird go-to crime to reference.
It's beyond weird. Especially an older man buying beer for younger girls.
Right. Again, you were a hero to them.
I wanted to give him the benefit of the doubt. You gotta stop saying that. I wanted to give him the benefit of the doubt that he tried to buy beer as an underage kid because some girls were there and he was trying to impress them.
No. No.
Well, because the next line he says, I got wore out by my daddy, which makes me think maybe, like, I don't know. But no, he says, I got wore out by my daddy for stealing cigarettes from the smokes and more. That's why he got wore out by his daddy. The first part is getting caught in Panama City, getting underage girls some beer. Jesus. What are you going to do for me, ladies? You know, I work in a bar. You ever want a gin and tonic at 1 p.m.? Coming into Marty's.
It has to be early afternoon.
Past 3:30, I can't help you, ladies. But before then...
Maybe if you give me a canteen, I could fill it up throughout the day and give it to you after my shift's over. Is that sexy?
I could take all the leftovers from the drinks that get ordered.
Oh, God. All right. We're done here. We're done here. God damn it. That's gross.
I can dump them all into a Coca-Cola bottle.
Empty the bar mat.
Oh, okay. That's the worst. Anyway. And all my friends would get away. Seems I'd get caught. Plain as day. I took the blame for every little thing. So this guy always gets caught. When everybody else gets away, he's the one that gets nailed for various innocent crimes like stealing cigarettes, buying underage girls beer. What? Anyway, song continues. But I got away with you, and somehow I still ain't been found out. It's a crazy truth. Like I strolled out the gates of Alcatraz and I walked into the Louvre. Now the Mona Lisa's hanging in my house. I bust out of Buckingham with the crown jewels, and I got away with you. What? I think he's bragging to her face about abducting her and making her his wife.
That does sound right.
It's like a more overt overboard. You ever see that with Kurt Russell and Goldie Hawn?
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, but there's no like head injury in this version. Yeah. He just took her.
The one thing to take from this is, without question, the Mona Lisa is the only painting he can name.
It's so ugly.
No, come on. What are you talking about?
What are you talking about?
The Mona Lisa?
The Mona Lisa.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's little.
It is little.
She's weird looking.
She's weird looking.
Okay, what are we arguing about?
It's a gorgeous painting.
No.
Go look at it up close, friend. It's
amazing.
They don't
let you anymore because everybody keeps putting paint on it.
Yeah, that's true.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's fucking phenomenal. It's shocking.
I guess I'll scooch up next time.
Yeah.
God, that's confusing. Anyway.
But again, it's the only painting he knows because it's the most famous painting in the world.
Of course. Well, looking like you do on its damn own should be a crime. Victim blaming. Let alone a fool like me, hand in hand with you, should be doing time. Yes, I agree. But here we are running free. Guess someone's turned the other cheek because there ain't no blue lights in my rear view. He's just overtly taunting the police. He's stolen this woman and brainwashed her into thinking she wants to be his wife. Jesus. I'll take it all. The fails, the falls, the county jails, and one phone calls. I'd do it all again if I had to. Even if they catch me and they lock me up and I gotta serve 10, 20, 30 years, I will get out and I will find you. And you will be my wife.
Ugh, it's got a real season 5 of Fargo feel to it.
God, John Hamm made me hate him so much. Physically angry at him in that show.
And in real life.
He's so handsome. That's a weird reason to dislike a man, but I get it.
Track number 12. Thankfully, the last track. Honky Tonk Highway.
Waving at the women that are standing in the ticket line.
Honky Tonk Highway.
Yeah, it's by far the worst song that starts with honky tonk we've discussed.
Sadly. It does open with some uncharacteristic reverse guitar playing, which of course sounds really good, so they stop doing that.
Yeah, this one sounds much different than the rest of the album. Honestly, I think we should rule of 11 with this. He tours with a band around SEC country. That's pretty much it.
Correct. They're shout outs to actual bus brands. I had to Google a bus brand. And for that, we will skip it. Track number... we're done. Tim, that's the part where we stop naming tracks that don't exist, and I say, how did this do? So, how did it do?
This hit number 1 on the U.S. Billboard Top Country Albums and number 4 on the U.S. Billboard 200. It was the best-selling country album in the U.S. in 2018. It was the best-selling country album in the U.S. in 2019. It was the second best-selling country album in the U.S. in 2020. It was the third best-selling country album in 2021. It was the fourth best-selling album.
What?
Best-selling country album in 2022.
2020. It was the 7th best-selling country album in 2023, and we don't have the numbers for 2024, but I'm going to guess 11.
I'm going to guess 8.
2019, this hit its 50th week at number 1 on the Billboard Country Album chart. It tied a record by Shania Twain's Come On Over, which is not the album we talked about on the Shania Twain episode. It was the 60th best-selling album of any kind from any artist in the U.S. from 2010 to 2019. This is certified sextuple platinum in the U.S. It has 2.7 million physical album sales. People fucking loved this.
Tim, are we wrong?
No, no. This is one of those, like super broad comedies, you know, the...
Oh, okay. It's Big Bang Theory.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is the CBS. No. CBS. We still court the...
Really?
We're trying. We got some paperwork that's been...
Does anybody else still make sitcoms?
Yeah. You know what? Your buddy Shane Gillis got a sitcom on, I think, Fox or Netflix or something. Tires. He works in a tire shop.
I am really proud of you right now. That's such a funny joke. Like, you have to know me pretty well to know, like, why that irritates me. It's a really good joke for me. I mean, you mostly, because it's at my expense, but it's very funny. Okay, listeners, come join the softer side of WIHTA for a moment. Hands down, if you want to watch a legit funny comedy sitcom in the classic, well, not that
I
classic.
I swear to God, if you recommend Tires, I'm going to slap you. I don't care what the consequences are.
Consequences be damned. Well, now I want to swerve just to see how that works out, but we don't have time for a full-out and slap fight. Instead, no, I'll give you my real answer. Watch Abbott Elementary on ABC. That show is legitimately funny. If you like a Parks and Rec style, fairly low-stakes sitcom, that's the closest I've seen. In fact, in some ways, it's too close at parts, but it's really good. Anyway, that's how it did. What did people think of it?
Well, we have no...
Bobby C.
There are... The CD version of this has 2,086 total reviews.
Whoa.
The vinyl has 6,191 total reviews.
What?
99% of those are people that are just like, love him, fucking great country, that kind of bullshit. So I actually have very few good ones, but I did read a lot of them.
Good for you.
JT Bowers from 2021 titled his or her review, More Than Meets the Ear.
Oh, man, they're not going to see it coming. I'm going to use the Transformers slogan, but I'm going to change it to ear, you see.
I never thought much about Luke Combs one way or the other until I saw an interview he had with Dan Rather. It prompted me to buy this album, and I'm glad I did. Nothing flashy here, just good music. 5 out of 5 stars.
I'm 79 years young. Caught Luke Combs on the latest Dan Rather. How do you even find Dan Rather? He has not been on the TV in a minute. Because he's on like Mark Cuban's channel, like HD. You're watching HDNet.
No, but he did save all those people's lives in Galveston.
Did he?
Yeah, that's how he got his start.
I mean, I really like him. I've met him twice.
Does he like you?
No. Doesn't know me from Adam, but I have actually met this man twice. I met him in Fort Worth, Texas and in Washington, D.C.
Mm.
Separate incidents. I shouldn't call them incidents. Mr. Rather, I'm sorry.
I'm Dan Rather.
Dustin Hancock, 2020, Luke Combs' best album. This is a great album. I picked it up after I got his first album, This One's For You, only to realize it's the same album with 4 extra songs, 5 out of 5 stars. That's a man who bought the deluxe album, which has the same name as this album, thinking it was a different album.
That's fucking awesome, because that makes zero sense. I guess he released a second version, or no, not even that. I guess he released a new album, but stuck with the same name, like nobody's ever done ever in the history of naming anything.
Counterpoint, Led Zeppelin.
Yeah, but they at least have Roman numerals.
Oh, do they?
I assume, right?
Just, I, oh, I just God, they might not. Self-titled.
Shit, you might be right, because we know them as those numbers,
right.
But I'm trying to think of the covers, and there's no...
I don't think they've got any... Well, there might be something on the
spine.
No,
they are, because remember, I have the Led Zeppelin 3 vinyl with the rotating disc.
Yeah, we all have it. I don't know why you're bragging.
We don't all have it.
We do. You have it? Well, you used to have it. I have 2 copies.
Ezekiel, go loot the vinyl.
Anyway, Garrett, Barbara, take good care of your CD and thy will last forever from 2019. Love all
That's
songs.
That's not true.
As I love Luck Combs, I'm so upset about the car dealerships don't add them in their vehicles anymore. 5 out of 5 stars. I believe she went to a car dealership that used to give her free country records when she bought a car.
I mean, yes, is based on the words you said. God, that's perplexing. I mean, adult illiteracy is no laughing matter.
It's kind of funny sometimes.
It's a little like, funny I mean, sometimes in this instance. Funny. That's true. Your inability to consistently read or write in the King's English is fascinating
now,
to me.
Now, it's got several of our interns in trouble when I did not recognize the word poison. It's probably a story for a different day.
I suppose so. Kind of want to hear it now.
John G. Grimaldi, 2018, titled his review, Luke Combs Writes Terrific Songs, Forgive Me.
Okay, he feels shame for his love.
It's two songs too short. Luke Combs writes terrific songs, Forgive Me, but I find When It Rains It Pours hysterical. It's the reason I bought the CD. Overall, all the songs are solid, but the CD left me unsatisfied and still hungry. 3 out of 5 stars.
That review is all over the place, and I don't think you helped things. John Grimaldi is a great name. You could be anything. You could do pest control, lawyer, doctor, fake doctor.
I think it's mostly blue collar.
Really?
Yeah, I think that's a name that screams New Jersey blue collar or possibly con man.
What about restaurateur?
Sure.
Jonathan Grimaldi.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Any other reviews, Tim?
Nah.
Great. Who's this for?
Apparently everybody.
Yes. Yes. Roughly.
I feel like it was designed by Suits after he made the record. They remade the record so that it was for everybody. But people love this guy and all of his songs. So good for him. It's not for me.
Yeah, Luke, write in hatepodmail@gmail.com. Did they like reproduce this album? What's going on here? Would you have preferred a more stripped down sound? Do your other albums have a different sound to them? Are they more mature topics?
I bet his other albums sound the same. I would be interested to know what he sounds like live. Like if it keeps this same sound. Cause like there's a lot of like Townes Van Zandt, a lot of his albums, they put in a lot of bullshit extra like instrumentation. And then when he did stuff live, it was just like solo acoustic.
Yeah.
And was way better. Yeah, I don't know.
That's a good question. Luke, write in, because we will not do the research. This episode is over. We're going to shred it and burn it.
This episode is over.
That might be the new end. Anyway, let's wrap it up here. Final thoughts, Tim.
Nah.
Not a great sign. Okay. We've been all the way through it. We asked it up top. We've pulled it apart. We skimmed a couple songs. Never a good sign. Tim, do you hate this album?
Garrett, I kind of do. It's far too boring.
Yes.
And I mean, we put a lot of life in it. I feel like the problem is this is a cry for help. He was writing all these songs about how he's an alcoholic and hates his life.
Yeah.
And then they're just like, let's put some little studio sheen on this and it'll be fine. And now he's trapped in this career that nobody wants, except for everybody that he and I don't want. And maybe you will find out. Garrett, do you hate this?
Do I hate it? No, I have to say no, but it is right there. It's right there. It's just so boring.
Yeah, I know. That's a bad thing.
They just, no risks taken anywhere. And listen, I appreciate that this is a very competent album. It obviously, everybody appreciates it. 6.5 million people appreciate it. Great job. Not for me. I'd like to hear him do some covers.
I think it would be interesting if we could hop in the old time machine and go back to him playing a shitty bar in 2014, even possibly playing a few of these songs, and then hearing this album, I think you would really hate it. Because I think this guy has some personality. I just don't think it comes across here.
I thought you were going to give us some sort of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure style revamp of Luke Combs. We're going to give him a bunch of albums and be like, listen to these. It's the Allman Brothers. Just put this in the mix. Figure it out. We're just gonna take this Florida Georgia Line and smash it.
Yeah, we could do that too.
Yeah, if we got a time machine.
You know,
we could probably
do
other stuff too.
I don't think he ever raps on this album. So that's good.
He doesn't, but he does. He borrows from R&B. We'll say that much. But he doesn't rap, and we appreciate it. There's no heavy beats, which is good for a country album by a guy named Luke. Alrighty, Tim, let's bring it home. That's going to do it for this week. As always, rate, review, subscribe, pledge your firstborn, blood sacrifice, whatever you got to do to let your various services know that you enjoy this podcast, thumbs up, etc. Most importantly, share it. If you like it, give it to another person. Although that is like universally the hardest thing to do is be like, hey, I like this podcast. You'd like it. Really? Where should I start? I mean, at bare minimum, have them skip the first 20.
Nah, 17. That's what you tell them.
All right. Don't go with the first 17.
B-A-N-A-N-A-S.
That is where something beautiful was born. Martin Luther, okay, computer. you can find us on the interwebs. That's hatepodmail@gmail.com. You can also go to hatepod.com and click on contact us in the upper left-hand corner. Everything seems to have been functioning properly so far. The whole thing needs to be moved, but that's a problem for a different day. You can also find every episode online and downloadable. I don't remember what the exact URL is. Type in the name of the show and an episode and you'll find it. They're all there.
Type in Libsyn in the
Help. Libsyn. That'll do it. You can find us on Instagram. That's HatePod. Twitter's album, HatePod. G. Harvey Tweets is who I am on Twitter if you would like to contact me. We got Discord servers, subreddits, all the different ways and communiques that are out there. So if you want to hit us up, please do. We will get back to you. It'll take a minute, but we will get back to you. We appreciate suggestions. So many emails that begin with, don't know if you take suggestions. We take them. For the love of God, we take them. But that's going to have to happen a different time. For this week, for next week, and a little bit for yesterday, I have been one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey.
I have been the other, Timothy P. Richardson. And on September 8th, 1978, Garrett P. Harvey said, and I quote, death to the Shah, death to death. Unclear what he meant by that. Would you care to comment?
I was not alive, and we're going to have to bleep a lot of that. God damn it. I did not say those things in public.
There's cowboys running through my dreams. Nothing's quite the way it seems. I joined the Navy, got kicked out in a week. My facial features aren't distinct. Try to find some meaning in these songs. The genius is a genius, got it wrong. No, it's a lobster murder sex thing. It's the bleaching of the rear. A full assault on both your ears. The riffs are too repetitive. The lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides. The cover art's a mess. Listen to it for a week, now that week has passed. It's the Why I Hate This Album podcast with Tim and Gary.